May I now invite Professor Rajan Harsey, an eminent Africanist, author, intellectual, thought leader. You know, he's written numerous books on Africa, Africa-India relations. Rajan Harsey, Professor Harsey brings that academic perspective here to the discussion today. Sir, you know, given your new book, which is about Africa, right? I would like you to focus primarily on how do you look at the pandemic? You know, there is talk about pandemic bringing down the growth rate, economic growth rate. But given Africa's pivotal role in advancing the UN reform process and the reform process of global governance institutions, do you think pandemic will diminish in Africa's capacity? Or in a way, it will serve as a provocation going forward to accelerate reform of global governance architecture. Since we have very limited time, if you address this question, it would be a value to all of us.
Thank you very much, Panish. Let me wish all the participants happy Eid and happy 25th May Africa Day. I will briefly address myself because a lot has been already said. The audience has been building and I know attention span of everybody can be limited. So let me just come straight to the brass tacks. One is that this pandemic is likely to continue for 6 to 8 months more very easily because there is no sign of vaccine everywhere. One very serious problem that India has been facing is because of this, it has disrupted India's economy, disrupted world economy, disrupted all the supply chains, reduced the demands. And it is really a major global crisis, a major crisis for India, and we have to come out of it. This is going to take quite a while before we come out. And still, in the past, India has always made opportunities out of crisis which came. Like in 1991, India came out of 1991 crisis when foreign exchange reserves were so limited. Today, India has robust foreign exchange reserves, but there are other problems in the economy. 2008 crisis also India faced, and I'm sure this particular crisis also India is going to face. And India and Africa both will kind of rebuild their partnership, they'll reunite and do many more things in the next decade to come. I think while hearing the speakers, I thought that some of the points which Ambassador Virendra Gupta made, I'll just try to put across or emphasize them more. One thing that I thought was, India has always emphasized on developing local capacities and capacity building in Africa, and that is necessary during this time. That initially, perhaps give them testing machines, you give them ventilators, you give them all such equipments which allow Africans to come out of this crisis, and India is also helping itself in this way. But subsequently, as the kind of capacity building also involves long-term plan towards education. And India and Africa, they have to have long-term plan towards education as well as health. Both these sectors require a great deal of investments and somewhere steps have to be taken around this right away. As far as education is concerned, I think India can share its expertise and learn from Africa and give Africa something most certainly, especially digital divide. Then scientific and technical knowledge. And this digital divide can be easily bridged because India surely is one of the important soft powers in the world today. And Africans can become drivers on the international superhighway if India's soft power is used, India's technical expertise is used, and they can access public health, they can access education. The Ministry of Education also started programs like E-Pathshala, where educational partnership, research and scientific development related partnership, if that is developed, I think we will have clear idea of facts and how we can proceed further. There is also one more area which both have to face apart from economy, and that is climate change. I think this is a serious issue, and India and Africa both have to work together to see that climate change challenges we are able to encounter. Already there is International Solar Alliance operating, 48 countries are members, 25 African countries are members of it. But most important part is evolving green technologies, evolving technologies and scientific research, which allows us to face climate problems and also persuading developed countries constantly to see that common differentiated responsibilities adhered to when climate change is faced, and that they should share burden of the finances to see that India and African countries together can get something out of them, and they need to give lots of funds. This what they give is very limited. They have to give funds and not impose reforms on developing world. Another problem that I thought I should say, and it is, you know, concerns broader area of security. I think not many people handled it, so I will quickly put across what I feel. There are traditional and non-traditional security areas, but security should be our priority. But suppose India wants to now start trading with the African countries, the entire Indian Ocean coast and that area is important, open, and there is so much of privacy, piracy. Similarly, if you look at, you know, terrorism, Al-Shabaab is working there, Boko Haram is working in Western Africa, and all other Al-Qaeda affiliates also are working. So somewhere handling terror, handling piracy will be important from India's point of view, because otherwise trade cannot begin. Already we have 70 billion trade, but it is dwindling. So how will we support trade? And that is a challenge we have to handle. Apart from, you know, handling kind of security somewhere, security and growth of all region is also our priority. And our Prime Minister has visited Seychelles, Mauritius, Mozambique, Tanzania, and all these areas, and they are going to contribute, because somewhere Indian Ocean is a very important between India and Africa. This particular partnership has to perhaps go on. And India has been also supporting AU's efforts in bringing about security, and India has supported UN missions, as Ambassador Chhabra mentioned, that 5,000 forces have participated already in this particular area. I would also like to say one more thing, that the youth-to-youth collaboration, India and Africa both have a large number of young people, and how will we work out the kind of demographic dividend by kind of employing our youth, making them kind of stimulated into something which is creative between the two, is also a challenge before us. I quite agree with Ambassador Virendra Gupta, you can't rely only on Pan-African networks. Somewhere private initiative also is necessary in this area, and how will it come, we have to think of, because of the set of years, we are going to communicate only in the digitalized world, and that has to be also addressed very squarely. Last point that I thought I should make is concerning democracy at large. I think democratization of world order, Ambassador Amni talked about. And as far as United Nations is concerned, surely Security Council requires reforms. BRICS and G20 country kind of require some admission. But democracy also is internal phenomena. And somewhere what India and Africa can take from each other has to be also understood. Somewhere I feel in a very important area of democracies, and India, for example, is a living democracy. Wonder that democracy has been among the world. India is a union of states. And somewhere it has also federalizing tendencies, and they matter. And there are countries in Africa which are now going into democratic system. And interestingly, Ethiopia, South Africa, and Nigeria, they are also working on federal lines. So how federalism can be strengthened, how federalism can be understood, how democratic governance can be understood, that can work out internally. Suppose you strengthen the bodies from local self-government to province to nation, I think democratic functioning goes on, and more democratic functioning, more ideas come, and less possibility of revolt, less possibility of tension. You can really silence guns with democracy. Africa has had very bitter experiences because of civil war, military dictatorships, secessionist movements, and only democracy can allow you that leisure to kind of get through. And how we'll function democratically, strengthen democracy first within our respective countries, then between India and Africa, and within the larger international politics of the world. All these are problems which we need to address. I think I have taken sufficient time. Financial resources are dwindling down, as you know, one is looking at world economy, and still when kind of man gets out to work and one thinks of COVID crisis subside, which is a liberal, we would have learned a lesson from this. There is one world in which we have to fight, and in this one world we have to get together and see that international organizations are strengthened. Self-reliance doesn't mean that we are isolating and autarkic, but we are kind of giving something of our own to poorer countries, giving them duty-free kind of concessions. Least developed countries also would require support from India, and at the same time take something out of them, like our energy requirements are there with Africa. And India has already, Nigeria, Angola, and Sudan, where India is collaborating in the energy sector. So the energy-hungry economy of India is stimulated. India can also take a generous position, stimulate kind of different things in Africa, where markets meet, people meet, and also there is a good treatment to Africans at by and large. And that point which Dr. Virendra Gupta Saab made, that the African students have to be treated also with respect in India. Many of students from Africa like Obasanjo, Buhari, this went back to Nigeria and headed the state. So we have to understand that when African students and 50,000 students are scholarship here, if they treat them properly, they will be ambassadors of India to Africa. And that's how partnerships can be built up. People-to-people relationships can be built up. I think I have spoken enough. Thanks ever so much for giving me the floor. And I'm sure questions will be there. I'll be ready to answer them. Thank you ever so much, Manish ji.